from the audience that we might have some very interesting dialogue. We have three very fine presenters who've written three very fine papers, and I'm going to introduce them in sequence. And then we're also very fortunate to have a practitioner, or perhaps former practitioner, Jim Nicholson here, who will serve as commentator, and he'll speak last on those papers. And then perhaps we'll let the three speakers maybe have a minute or two to respond to Mr. Nicholson's comments. And then we'll open the floor to you. And we want to try to preserve as much time for you as possible. So I'm going to ask each of the speakers to please respect the 10-minute time limit. I'll give you little flashcards, and when I give you the one that says stop, if you would please stop shortly thereafter, very shortly thereafter, and then we'll give our commentator a little extra 15 minutes. And then, like I said, we're going to try to spend most of the time hearing from you in a dialogue, especially students. We had a request from one of our presenters that those of you who are toward the back of the room, since there are a lot of empty seats so far at least, if you would be so kind as to move forward, we'd appreciate it. So I'll leave that to you. In any case, welcome again. Our first presenter is Jeremy Kuzmarov, who is the author of The Myth of the Addicted Army, Vietnam and the Modern War on Drugs, and also Modernizing Repression, Police Training and Nation Building in the American Century. And he has been a professor at Emmanuel College, Bucknell University, and the University of Tulsa. Jeremy.
If you can get that PowerPoint. Great. Okay. Well, thanks. Yeah, first I just want to say that a full copy of my talk, I have extra copies. It's a talk that was published in the Asia Pacific Journal, which is a journal that covers Southeast Asian studies as well as critical analysis of U.S. foreign policy, and I have extra copies. So we have about a 15-minute limit, so I'll just kind of summarize the paper here. And I want to thank everybody for coming. It's a great honor to be speaking at this event, and I wish John Negroponte and Porter Goss could stay for my talk, because I was actually asking Mr. Goss about the privatization of intelligence, which is my topic. And you have an image here, his bulging left bicep featuring a tattoo of a panther and his right one of the Grim Reaper. Wolf Weiss was a heavy metal guitarist from Los Angeles, dubbed by Rolling Stone magazine the heavy metal mercenary. His team, the Wolverines, was known for provocative displays of force, going by the motto, strike down thine enemies and vanquish all evil by the right hand of God. Strength and honor to all who live by the code of the warrior. In November 2004, en route to Baghdad Airport, Weiss's vehicle was ambushed by U.S. soldiers who mistook him for an insurgent. He was shot in the head and tragically killed. He had told Rolling Stone that, quote, war was one of the few things in the world I can do really well. A lot of people are calling us private armies, and that's basically what we are. This is not a security force, this is a paramilitary force. This talk, it should be noted, when I published the article, there were comments at the bottom that says Weiss was not a representative, because I go into a little bit, he actually killed several civilians, and there are people from the heavy metal community who said, Weiss does not represent us at the bottom of the article. So, but he's, you know, this new form of warrior that was sent to fight this war on terror. And this talk, and the article goes in much more detail, details the role of private military corporations in America's long Iraq war in light of a century-long history of the U.S. use of mercenary and clandestine forces throughout the world. It shows the multiple ways of mercenary war as a means of concealing military intervention from public view. The Bush administration carried these practices to extreme levels, in part, I think, because of the Vietnam syndrome and because the public was so polarized, it had to be concealed. There had to be this reliance on private forces, and the, dirty work in some ways had to be concealed. But this has gone on for many years, of course. Mercenaries have been an element of U.S. foreign policy strategy, but Bush carried these practices to extreme levels, particularly in financing organizations which profit from war and are hence dedicated to its perpetuation. Mercenaries have long been part of U.S. war making going back to the 19th century when they worked to pacify revolutionary movements. Yeah, although Goss in his talk said the U.S. is the greatest force for good in world history, but perhaps he should study some history, because if you look at the history of mercenaries, they were used to pacify revolutionary movements on behalf of the banana companies, for instance, in Central America, and served U.S. dictators who, quote, smile benevolently on U.S. enterprise in the tropics. Throughout the Cold War, the U.S. relied on companies like Civil Air Transport, later Air America, to fight revolutionary movements. In Congo, they financed South African and Rhodesian mercenaries after the murder of Patrice Lumumba. In Saudi Arabia, Vinel Corporation, a private company, was hired to equip the Saudi National Guard. Saudi Arabia is one of the most repressive governments in the world that we continuously support. And Vinel was hired by them to suppress rebellions after Vietnam, overseeing the kingdom's internal security forces into the 21st century. From 1994, I agree with the commentator who said we do see continuities from Clinton to Bush. From 94 to 2002, the Pentagon signed more than 3,000 contracts with U.S.-based firms valued at $300 billion. Military Professional Resources Incorporated was one of the largest companies operating in Iraq that started to get major contracts in the 90s, often to train quite repressive governments. Its Virginia headquarters displayed a plaque which read, "War is an ugly thing, but not the ugliest of things. The decayed and degraded state of moral and patriotic feeling, which thinks that nothing is worth war, is much worse." One of its CEOs, so this gives you a sense of the mentality of the people involved, one of its CEOs bragged, "We've got more generals per square foot here than in the Pentagon." The global war on terror was considered the Super Bowl. It was taken to new levels, the Super Bowl for private military contractors who made over $100 billion in Iraq alone by 2008. A senior officer commented, "The Pentagon is no longer a warfighting organization, it is a business enterprise. There is so much money being made, who would ever think of cutting back?" They're not cutting back currently. As resistance to the U.S. occupation intensified, the military became overstretched in the absence of a draft and began lowering its recruitment standards. This is one reason for the reliance on private military contractors. Actually, there was an expose that showed the Army went so low as to hire ex-criminals and even neo-Nazis and gangsters who had been excluded in the past. And numbers of soldiers, as Amy Goodman said heroically, refused to serve in that illegal war. Private contractors filled a key void, performing key military functions like protecting diplomats, transporting supplies, guarding checkpoints and other strategic facilities, providing intelligence, carrying out interrogation, and even loading bombs onto CIA drones. A British mercenary said that military commanders, quote, "do not like us, but tolerate us as a necessary evil, because they know that if it wasn't for us, they would need another 25 to 50,000 troops on the ground, and this was impossible in the absence of a draft and in the post-Vietnam political climate." The Bush administration has a stain on its record, hired companies in Iraq with known links to human rights abuses, such as Wackenhut, which had worked with the Christian far right in the Cold War to develop databases on leftists and union activists and train death squads, some of which actually were overseen by the Ambassador Negroponte in Central America. Aegis Defense Limited was headed by Tim Spicer, who was involved in shady coups in Africa. These are the kind of companies that were hired. So is it a surprise that they had a terrible record in Iraq? In 2005, Aegis Defense employees put up an online video of colleagues firing on civilian cars to the backdrop of Elvis Presley's Mystery Train. This incident was one of many atrocities committed by private military contractors in Iraq, including the infamous Nusur Square massacre involving Blackwater. One colonel, Theodore Westhusing, who might have made it into Amy's book, reported on these abuses by U.S., in particular a company called U.S. Investigative Services. He in turn committed suicide, stating, quote, "he did not volunteer to support corrupt money-grubbing contractors, nor work for commanders only interested in themselves," referring directly to St. David Petraeus, at least as he was portrayed in the U.S. media, who actually oversaw USIS operations, which included torture. Some of the torture was actually carried out by these private contractors. Now, mercenary units, it's very shady when, I think, governments start hiring mercenaries, because we know that mercenary units throughout history have been known for brutality, as they're often motivated by financial gain, and they also attract a certain kind of person. Contractors in Iraq had legal immunity and did not follow rigorous recruitment standards. There was also a cult of militarized masculinity greater than the army itself. Many took steroids and sat around in their off hours drinking beer. And yeah, you can look at Weiss, and perhaps he was on steroids. They would sit in their off hours drinking beer, bragging about how many hajis they had killed. One Triple Canopy employee, and Amy, to her credit, has done a lot of exposés on these companies on her show. One Triple Canopy employee stated, "It was like romanticizing the idea of killing to the point where dudes want to do it. You're not a real man until you've dropped the guy." This is the kind of culture that existed, and it's documented in a number of books. While often touting their patriotism, money, of course, was the main motivation. One employee of Crescent, this trucking company, said he always liked this kind of work as he had been in the Marines, but he was also getting caught up on some bills, and I heard they're coming out with that new Dodge Challenger in 2008. I want that. John Cote was a University of Florida student and Army veteran who worked for the same company and told a reporter, "This place, Iraq, is a money-making machine. There's just so much of it. It really amazes me, a war, how it creates money, generates it, how war can be profited off. All you have to do is look around, the amount of food, fuel, and oil, and pardon my language, shit, that we use over here. All the companies that work over here are getting rich over here." Cote was subsequently kidnapped by insurgents and killed 1 week before he was slated to return to college. His comments reveal a kind of political awakening as to his place in the system and the economic forces that had staked perpetuating the war long after its original purpose had receded. The ascendancy of neoliberal economic philosophy since the 1970s has coincided with the growth of hyper-consumerist and individualistic philosophies embodied in the mantra promoted by Ronald Reagan that greed is good. And this is the mantra, I think, of the Bush administration. Private contractors like Cote and their bosses were the ultimate embodiment of this value system. Like the gold rushers and filibusters of yesteryear, they thrust morality aside in seeking to cash in on the war economy and thought little about the consequences for the Iraqi or Afghan people. And some paid the ultimate price. The war in Iraq and the way it was fought, however, exposed for the world the dark consequences of running a society guided by selfish principles. Greed is not good. Mercenaries and the bad publicity that they generated led many people to recognize, indeed, this, that greed is not good and will lead us to a new dark age if we embrace this slogan. Unfortunately, yeah, I have more stories about the contractors, but I have to conclude my talk. So, and of course, they were involved in a lot of black operations and this kind of stuff, and many did serve as CIA fronts. Jeremy Scahill wrote the best expose. I'll mention one thing, a story of Dewey Claridge went under a private contract to collect intelligence and was feeding misinformation to Fox News that was used to promote a more aggressive military policy. I'm just going to conclude. And this is the danger. There is a danger if you have private individuals who have their own agendas and are working for companies who are profiting off war, are actually feeding the public misinformation to support the continuation of these wars. And this has helped to erode our democracy. And in fact, in the age of, well, it started before, the Center for Public Integrity reported that 14 companies awarded government contracts in both Iraq and Afghanistan, donated almost $23 million in political contributions since 1990, with George W. Bush receiving more money from these companies than any other candidate, including $80,000 from Blackwater. And this is corrupting our democracy. They're financing elections, these companies that have a vested interest in perpetuating the wars. And let me conclude with Edward Gibbon. Edward Gibbon, in his monumental The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, attributed Rome's collapse in good measure to the abandonment of military service and dependence on the rude valor of barbarian mercenaries. While it is difficult to tell if the U.S. is headed the way of Rome, what is clear is that the use of mercenaries failed to turn the tide in the protracted U.S. wars in Afghanistan and Iraq and has paved the way for blowback. Warp spending priorities accentuated by these private companies and their lobbyists, together with political gridlock in U.S. politics, have resulted in fiscal insolvency, decaying public services, and Rusty touched on this very well in her talk, declining educational standards, think where this money could have gone to repair our communities, and inability to confront environmental, immigration, and major social problems. before it is too late, us, the progressive forces, the young people, have to mobilize under the goal of reorienting American foreign policy in a more peaceful direction. Congressional investigations along the lines of the 1930s Nye Commission on corporate war profiteers and 70s Church Committee hearings on CIA abuses would be a good start in raising public awareness that could ultimately lead to new legislation to outlaw these companies and bring back our democracy. Thank you.
Asked to give very short introductions, so the folks that I'm introducing have very long CVs, but I'm just going to mention only a couple highlights. So we're going to do a little bit of a switcheroo on you here. The paper that we're going to hear about next is called Presidential Decision-Making in Iraq, Bush versus Bush, Phronesis versus Faith. The paper was written by Michael Genovese, who holds the Loyola Chair of Leadership Studies and is Professor of Political Science and Director of the Institute for Leadership Studies at Loyola Marymount University. However, Professor Genovese couldn't be here, so Nancy Cassop has been kind enough to volunteer to present the paper in his stead. Nancy Cassop is a professor in the Department of Political Science and International Relations at the State University of New York at New Paltz. Professor Cassop.
Thank you for the introduction, and also thank you for permitting me to present Michael Genovese's paper. He regrets he cannot be here in person due to a family emergency. Professor Genovese's paper is a tale of two Bushes, father and son, and two wars in Iraq. It examines this rather unique phenomenon of two presidents from the same family, a generation apart, both engaging the United States in wars in Iraq, or as he puts it, one Gulf, two wars. But that is where the similarity ends. On every measure, the contrast between Bush 41 and Bush 43 could not be more apparent or more complete. For each war, Professor Genovese compares the foreign policy credentials and worldview of 41 and 43, the prelude to each of these military conflicts, the advisory system used by each president, the decision-making process used by each one to initiate hostilities, the goals each wanted to achieve in their respective ventures in Iraq, and the outcome of each war in terms of meeting the objectives set for it at the start. On all of these factors, Professor Genovese presents diametrically opposite conclusions for both men. It's a clever device to compare the performance of father and son, and the stark polarity of their findings merit our attention for what they suggest about the impact of presidential personality as well as political context on foreign policy making, and most especially on critical decisions to go to war. He begins by discussing the dilemma faced by the United States policymakers after the Vietnam War, where the burden for articulating the rationale for any subsequent military intervention was to convince a skeptical and war-weary public that such action was vital to American interests and that it met the standards of the Weinberger Doctrine, that any use of force should be overwhelming and with the goal of winning, that there must be clear and unambiguous political objectives, that military action must be proportional to the objectives sought, that it must have the support of Congress and the American people, and that the commitment of United States troops should be done only as a last resort. Professor Genovese concludes that George H.W. Bush largely followed these guidelines in the run-up to the Persian Gulf War of 1991, while George W. Bush in the Iraq War of 2003, much less so. The first Gulf War was relatively short, quickly achieved its stated goals with the support of a wide international coalition, and with fewer than 300 American casualties. The second war in Iraq was militarily successful in its initial phase, where the United States was joined by a much smaller coalition of nations, where Saddam Hussein was deposed and eliminated, but the war dragged on and became a civil war with sectarian violence that continued far beyond the end of the George W. Bush presidency, left Iraq in tatters with no plan for the aftermath of the conflict, and resulted in more than 4,400 American deaths. Looking more closely at a comparison of the factors mentioned at the outset, Professor Genovese offers these following observations. George H.W. Bush came to the presidency with a sterling set of foreign policy credentials and government experience, having served as the United States ambassador to China, a member of Congress, director of the CIA, and vice president. He was fully formed from the moment he stepped into the Oval Office, was pragmatic, non-ideological, a problem solver, and had an interest in and understanding of the foreign policy process. By contrast, George W. Bush openly admitted that he had a lot to learn about foreign affairs. Bush Sr. was advised by seasoned foreign policy professionals such as Brent Scowcroft, James Baker, Colin Powell, and yes, Dick Cheney, but also made his famous phone calls reaching out to others for counsel and made his decision to intervene militarily to drive Hussein out of Kuwait and back into Iraq only after careful deliberation and gradual calibrated actions. He assembled a broad coalition, gained support of the American public, as well as United Nations backing for military action and authorization from Congress to use military force, although he argued publicly, as many presidents do, that congressional authorization was actually constitutionally unnecessary, though politically desirable, using rather colorful language to express this when he said, quote, "I didn't have to get permission from some old goat in Congress just to kick Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait," end quote. From administration memoirs and journalistic accounts, we learn that George W. Bush, by contrast, circumscribed the advice he received by marginalizing dissenters and opposing voices, such as those of Colin Powell and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and that the proposal of an invasion of Iraq was discussed by Cheney and Rumsfeld as early as the administration's first National Security Council meeting on January 30th, 2001. The attacks of September 11th, though having no connection to Iraq or Saddam Hussein, offered a convenient pretext for taking out Hussein, and in November 2001, the president told Rumsfeld that, quote, "it was time to turn to Iraq." Professor Genovese offers that key decisions seemed to have made before discussion and review, assumptions were reinforced before they were examined, and information was presumed true before the evidence even arrived at the White House. And then there was the infamous Downing Street memo in which the head of British intelligence told Prime Minister Blair on July 23, 2002, 3 months before Bush would ask Congress for authorization to use force, that, quote, "military action by the United States against Hussein was now seen as inevitable and that the intelligence and facts were being fixed around the policy with little discussion in Washington of the aftermath of military action." Professor Genovese describes this as working backwards, knowing the decision you want to make and then just finding or fitting the facts to justify it. Moreover, he characterizes the advisory system used by George W. as rigid and closed, in contrast to George H.W.'s willingness to seek broader advice beyond his closed circle. Richard Haass, foreign policy advisor to both Bushes, perhaps captured best the perplexing and unsettling nature of George W.'s decision-making on Iraq. Haass says, and I quote, "How did George W. Bush reach this point? I will go to my grave not fully understanding why, although I believe I have a good, if not complete, understanding of how this second Iraq war came about. There is no certainty, as there was no meeting or set of meetings at which the pros and cons were debated and a formal decision taken. No, this decision just happened. It was cumulative. The issue was on the table from the outset of the administration." In comparing the war in Iraq with that of Afghanistan, Haass says, and I quote, "Iraq was fundamentally different. The president wanted to destroy an established nemesis of the United States, and he wanted to change the course of history, transforming not just a country, but the region of the world that had produced the lion's share of the world's terrorists and had resisted much of modernity. He may have sought to accomplish that what his father did not, the arguments put forward for going to war in Iraq, noncompliance with United Nations resolutions, possession of weapons of mass destruction, all turned out to be essentially window dressing, trotted out to build domestic and international support for a policy that had been forged mostly for other reasons. The fact that Iraq was not involved in 9/11 or tied to Al-Qaeda, despite repeated intimations and claims by the president and others to the contrary, mattered not. Indeed, the president's instruction to counterterrorism coordinator Richard Clark to look for a connection between Iraq and 9/11 when there was no reason to suspect one seemed more than anything to reflect a desire to justify a course of action that Bush had already was inclined to take. The fact that Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld instructed Central Command in November 2001 to begin planning for a war with Iraq just reinforces this point. Again, Haass writes, quote, "The fundamental decision to go to war against Saddam's Iraq had effectively been made by a president and an administration with virtually no systematic, rigorous in-house debate," end quote. The president and his vice president were so enamored of the idea that in the end they believed what they wanted to believe rather than follow the evidence. On two other dimensions, management style and approach to decision making, scholars and others have described George W. as using a hierarchical, ordered corporate style that relies on delegating to loyal advisors while characterizing his personal decision making as deeply prompted by gut instincts. He told Bob Woodward specifically, quote, "I'm not a textbook player, I'm a gut player." Woodward wrote that, quote, Bush's leadership bordered on the hurried. He wanted actions, solutions. Once on a course, he directed his energy at forging on, rarely looking back, scoffing at, even ridiculing, doubt and anything less than 100% commitment. He harbored few, if any, regrets, end quote. In the end, what can we conclude about the two Bushes and the two wars with Iraq? Professor Genovese sets his observations and research within three simple levels of analysis: individual, institutional, and systemic. On the individual level, George Sr. exhibited cognitive, emotional, experiential, and interpersonal strengths, while George Jr. appeared lacking in these qualities. Professor Genovese applies the Aristotelian concept of phronesis to George Sr. The shorthand definition of the term is, quote, practical wisdom or prudence or achieving your goals while recognizing the limits imposed by context. Bush Sr. stopped short of removing Hussein from power specifically because he believed it would result in an untenable United States occupation of Iraq. George Jr.'s goals were to use Iraq as the opening salvo to bringing democracy to the Middle East, an excessively ambitious and ultimately unrealizable objective. George Sr.'s practical wisdom that builds from deliberation and contrast George Sr.'s practical wisdom that builds from deliberation and that acknowledges limits and works within them with George Jr.'s reliance on faith, instinct, and determined action to achieve a messianic goal. Turning to the institutional level, Professor Genovese concludes that Bush Sr. made far greater use of process in seeking advice, while Bush Jr., as described above, relied on faith and certainty. On the systemic level, Bush Sr. was successful in gaining domestic and international support and a UN authorizing resolution, while Bush Jr. also received popular and congressional support at home, but his international coalition paled in comparison to his father's, and he was unable to secure UN backing for military intervention. Ultimately, Professor Genovese concludes that on all three levels, presidents can shape the course of actions and that who sits in the Oval Office matters. One Bush waged a limited war, the other a far more aggressive one. One responded to Iraqi aggression and the invasion of Kuwait, the other started a preventive war. One explored policy options before deciding, the other made quick judgments from which any subsequent questioning or backtracking was viewed as unacceptable weakness. One succeeded in rallying the international community to its cause, the other managed only to cobble together a small coalition of the willing. One came to the office with the benefit of vast experience, the other was sorely lacking in foreign policy expertise and preferred to delegate that realm to others. One final observation from Richard Haass sums this up succinctly, quote, that the two conflicts were undertaken by a father and his son for such different reasons, in such different ways, and with such different results, constitutes one of the great curiosities of this or any era, as those who write about history are sure to conclude. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kassab. And for our final presentation, I'm pleased to introduce presenting a paper entitled Occupying Iraq, A Tragedy Foretold, Hofstra's own Carolyn Eisenberg, who's a professor here, professor of history, United States history, and foreign policy.
Well, actually, the last paper made the beginning of my paper easier. So there's like a little quiz I want to do. I'm going to start with a quote, don't go to sleep. Trying to eliminate Saddam, extending a ground war into an occupation of Iraq would have incurred incalculable human and political costs. Going in and occupying Iraq, thus unilaterally exceeding the UN mandate, would have destroyed the precedent of international response to aggression that we hope to establish. In final sense, had begun the invasion route, the United States could conceivably still be an occupying power in a bitterly hostile land. So who said that? Some genius, anybody? Yes? Right. George Bush and his national security advisor, Brent Scowcroft, and that was in their memoir. I don't want to spend this whole panel extolling George Sr., about whom my own views are more mixed. But, and nor is the moral of this story to read your father's books. Although it is a question, did he ever read Dad's book? But even if he didn't like to read books, there was, in addition, on August 15th, 2002, in the Wall Street Journal, a very interesting article by his dad's national security advisor, Brent Scowcroft. "We need to think through this issue very carefully," he had counseled. "Perhaps the most dire consequences would be in the region where there would be an explosion of outrage against us. If the United States invaded Iraq, this could destabilize Arab regimes and likely swell the ranks of the terrorists. In other words, if the goal was to defeat terrorism, this fork in the road would point the United States in the opposite direction." So that's Dad's national security advisor. By any calculus, the Bush administration's decision to invade and occupy Iraq ranks among the most disastrous in modern history. Yet even now, there's a disposition to write it off as a simple mistake, resulting from poor intelligence reporting. This bland formulation can soothe the American conscience and diminish official culpability. However, it also obscures the vast human tragedy inflicted on millions of people for reasons that are deeply rooted in our institutions and ideology. In the absence of that remembrance, it is no surprise that U.S. policy in the present period continues that familiar trajectory. Why did the Bush administration invade Iraq, a country that had no connection to the attacks on September 11th? I think this is like the 30th time somebody has made that point in this conference, so I don't want to, but why did they do it is a very big question. Now, in his memoir, the president says, well, it's really simple. The intelligence analysts had unanimously concluded that Saddam Hussein possessed weapons of mass destruction, which after 10 years he was still refusing to surrender, and given his known predilection for terrorists, there was a danger he would make this available to our enemies. So as a matter of national security, he had to act. Now, there was the embarrassing fact that there were no weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, nor any evidence that there was a link to terrorists. And Bush is sad about that. He says it was a blow to his personal credibility. After all, he had sent Americans into combat based in large part on intelligence that proved false. Okay, but he still resents all those protesters, you know, with their placards saying Bush lied, people died, a claim he rejects. For historians, a final verdict on whether or not Bush purposefully exaggerated the facts, was misled by subordinates, or simply telling the truth as he saw it must await the declassification of government records. But regardless, the effort to explain the administration's policy decision does not rest exclusively on the president's personal psychology and motivation. No matter how powerful, every chief executive is dependent on cabinet members, his national security advisor, and others to give him reliable and clearly articulated policy choices. With regard to Iraq, we know that the analysts did not agree on whether Saddam Hussein possessed weapons of mass destruction or on his supposed connection to terrorists. We know as well that Vice President Cheney and members of the staff exerted significant pressure on the CIA to conclude that Saddam Hussein had these weapons and he was reconstituting his nuclear program. So in light of these circumstances, one could plausibly say, well, the president was taken in by subordinates. Yet that still leaves unexplained the president's, and I spoke about this earlier, doesn't explain why the president did not address the findings of two teams of international weapons inspectors who were operating in Iraq during the 2 months prior to the invasion. Now forgotten that they were even there, these inspectors roamed all over Iraq in quest of chemical and biological weapons and a nuclear program. And in the respect to the nuclear program, they found nothing. And the head of the International Atomic Energy Commission says very unlikely that there was any such program at all. And Hans Blix, who was head of the chemical biological weapons team, also didn't find anything, even though supposedly we knew where the weapons were. He wasn't 100% sure. He asked for more time. The president decided not to give it to him. A more curious president or a president that wanted to avoid war might have waited to see if these weapons would turn up, but Bush was in a rush. He didn't wait because there was an overriding disposition at the highest levels of his administration to go to Baghdad and get rid of Saddam Hussein as quickly as possible. And that grew actually more urgent every day because the more that the weapons inspectors were operating, the more countries are saying, well, really? Why are they not finding anything? Maybe there isn't anything. So they couldn't afford to wait, and they rushed. I'm trying to condense a very long paper, into a short time. I mean, what's interesting is the eagerness of the Bush administration to go to Iraq, okay? And that, as several others have pointed out, that eagerness was present from the moment that the planes struck the Twin Towers and the Pentagon, right? The fires are still burning down at Ground Zero, and Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz are saying, what's the link to Saddam Hussein? It was no secret that the inner circle of Bush had been advocating military action against Iraq since the late 1990s. During the Clinton years, they'd been affiliated with the Project for a New American Century, a nonprofit educational organization which had urged a more assertive U.S. foreign and defense policy across a wide array of issues. High on their priority list was the possibility that Saddam Hussein could, at some time in the future, I shouldn't say priorities, but high on their list of concerns, was the prospect that Saddam Hussein could, at some time in the future, endanger American interests once the UN-imposed sanctions were removed. Yet these sanctions, yet these interests had less to do with national security as conventionally understood, since very few people actually thought that Saddam Hussein was going to attack the United States. It really had more to do with worries about his future influence in the Persian Gulf. The political problem this group faced was that even after Bush became president, it was difficult to convince the American public that invading Iraq, which was after all not attacking anybody, showed no signs of attacking anybody, how are you going to get the American public to agree to go to war with him? And of course, that's where 9/11 proved to be very, very significant. It actually changed the thinking to some extent of the president and foreign policy elites. Here was the United States looking so weak. If 19 people with knives and box cutters could get on our plane and create this level of havoc, how strong of a country could we actually be? And why should the United States tolerate an enemy that could maybe inflict significant danger down the road? So there's a number of incentives there to attack Saddam Hussein, but what's really interesting, and I'm trying to rush with this time, but what's really interesting is not why were there some incentives to do it, but why is it that the people in power completely wrote off the possible downsides of what they were doing, the kinds of things that Bush Sr. actually worried about, right? What did they think was going to happen when 130,000 American soldiers marched into a country of 24 million people and decapitated its government? How could they bring order to a society whose traditions, language, religion, and culture were so vastly different from their own? And if the United States was relying on shock and awe to pave the way, which meant thousands of bombs dropped on Baghdad and elsewhere, how would that calm a Muslim world already antagonized by Guantanamo prison, airstrikes in Afghanistan, U.S. support for a right-wing Israeli government, and a range of other behaviors? And finally, what would happen to a regional balance if you eliminated an Iraqi government opposed to Iran and empowered a Shiite minority to take control of the country?